deer and the antelope play, where seldom is heard a discouraging word, and the skies are not cloudy all day.
The pioneers and settlers, so many of them came from Missouri and Kansas, where there are a lot of smaller creeks and warm rainfall, and they were used to trees in those states, and there was nothing really here. It must have been very bleak. In fact, when my mother came to teach in 1928 as a young teacher, just right up college, she came with several other teachers, and they came by train, got in off in Kit Carson, and they were just shocked that there was nothing resembling a tree and very few houses, and they were just plaster, kind of a gray. They didn't believe in paint, apparently.
You know, there's days here where the wind is blowing 50 miles an hour and there's tumbleweeds or dirt blowing across the plains, and it's miserable. And you think, we have these homes and we can go and turn on the TV or, you know, have a cold glass of water, do our laundry. Well, 100 years ago, these pioneer women lived in a shack, and they probably came from the east where there's beautiful trees and green grass, and now they're in the middle of this dirty eastern Colorado, and there's not a tree around or other people. And so maybe that spirit gets ingrained in generations as families stay here on the land.
The geography of Kit Carson would be kind of rolling prairie, you know, beautiful sunsets and sunrises. My wife Amy always thinks it reminds her of the ocean. The rolling hills, kind of like the waves, you know, just you can see forever. You know, I think it's a certain type of environment that just grows on people, I guess.
Kit Carson is a very small town, but I remember it, and it still is very close-knit. Everyone knows everyone. And the generations of people, whether you're 95 years old or 5 years old, everyone has some type of relationship.
So these agricultural towns are really, I mean, the population is really decreasing generally. And it's too bad because it's, I think it's a great place to raise families, and all these youth, you know, they learn a lot working on the ranches and farms.
You know, I wouldn't change where I grew up. You know, I loved it. And hopefully it's a great place for my kids to grow up.
Well, it was kind of a station, I guess, in the 1870s and 80s. There was a lot of buffalo hunting in the area. And then some pioneers would go through this area, and scouts, Indian scouts and army. So it was an active crossroads. From Kit Carson, there was a railroad put in about 1870. It was the Kansas Pacific had come from Kansas City and stopped at Kit Carson, but it went southwest towards Los Animas, which is about 80 miles southwest. So that provided a few jobs, and people would come for trading and groceries and so forth. But it was not large town, I imagine 800 or so. Kit Carson, the scout, came through Kit Carson often. His business with the Indians, you know, cavalry and so forth. So that was the naming in honor of him. But he covered a great area. He went to Santa Fe and Taos and Denver. For those days, he just had a horse. I mean, it's amazing how they were so mobile and just could get miles and miles really as easily as you travel now to Santa Fe or something. As I say, it was busy. It had a livery stable and a grocery store, the necessities. So it grew to about 1,500 people approximately. It was open range, and there was no fences between here and Pueblo, say 120 miles or so. And the settlers or homesteaders would file on 160 acres, which they would own but they needed to live there. They call it proven, I guess, or proving up or something, in order to establish residence and ownership. But that was not enough to survive that 160 acres here. In the east, 160 acres, you could at least grow gardens and grains and so forth, but you really couldn't do it here to enough to provide for a family or anything. So they had some open range, and I might have 15 cows or something, and then they would just turn them loose, and they would just wander around and be in open range with other cattle, with other people. And then it was about probably 1920, approximately, or maybe a little before, when they began fencing the country. Fencing of this area was a big step forward. I mean, you could manage keeping them close and watching their health and so forth.
Oh, give me land, lots of land under starry skies above. Don't fence me in. Let me ride through the wide open country that I love. Don't fence me in.
My grandfather, Charles Edward Collins, and he went by Charlie, pretty much. He was born in Baxter Springs, Kansas. Let's see, I think in 1870, I believe. He left home, they said, at 13, because he wanted to be a cowboy. And that little town of Baxter Springs, there weren't lots of farming, I guess, but not too many cattle in that area at the time. So he took off and went through the Oklahoma country and eventually ended up in Mexico, because he'd heard they were driving cattle from there up to Bozeman in Billings, Montana. That was kind of a destination, and Abilene, Kansas, because that was a shipping point for the railroads to take the cattle on the rail. So he decided he wanted to do that, and of course it was easy to secure a job because they needed cowboys. And he joined up and did that for quite a few years. I imagine about 10 or 12 years, drove cattle. And he came through this country. They watered, like you say, there was this creek here, Big Sandy, and then Rush Creek south. And there were watering holes in the creek. But now we have water every few miles provided by water pipelines and windmills. But that, in those days, was very difficult to find water for cattle. But there was some in this area, so he remembered this area later years. And a bank in Kansas City had a mortgage on this particular ranch and persuaded him to take over the management while they decided whether to sell it or what to do with it. And he did that for a few years, and then they offered to him the chance to purchase it with a loan from them, which he decided to do. In the meantime, his first wife, Blanche Gregg, her maiden name was Gregg, she was from Baxter Springs. They had three children. Georgia, the oldest daughter, she was about 8 years older than my dad. And then Pauline, and then my dad, Don. And my grandfather, Charlie, named him Don Carlos Collins, from being in Mexico, which means Mr. Charles Collins. Instead of Charles Edward Jr., he named him Don Carlos. His friends would call him D. Carlos or Carlo, you know, just for fun. But I thought that was interesting, because my grandfather really was influenced by the Spanish architecture and way of ranching, and it made a real impression on him. And that's why they built this house where Toby and Amy live, designed after the hacienda in Mexico. Anyway, when he came to the ranch, his first wife, as I said, died in childbirth of my father with kidney infection. And those days, there was, of course, no antibiotics, no treatment. And three or four years later, he married Mary Smethers, who worked in a bank at Emporia, Kansas. And that was kind of unusual in those days. Women didn't work very much. But anyway, he convinced her. They started dating, and he married her So she took on these three stepchildren. And she had probably a pretty kind of protective life there, comfortable in trees and water. And, and so she had not been out here, of course. But Charlie decided that he's going to build this house, which would be 1906, I believe. And they had brought some Mexicans from Mexico to build it, to make the adobe and do the building. And so he wanted it to be finished for his new wife and the children. And they came out by train to Galatea, which is nothing now, but it was just a railroad stop. It was not a town exactly, but it's about 40 miles south of here. Charlie sent a couple cowboys in a wagon and a team over them to meet them because they had luggage and trunks and so forth. So my grandmother Mary, I think she was just astonished at the terrain and the type of country it was. She just, there was nothing to look at. Very, the rabbits and coyotes and so forth, and no water any place in sight. But they came on over here that day. I think it took them quite a few hours to get here. And then they came to down that bank, which is now there, kind of a sandbank there, and came down there, and she said, at least this looked more pleasant, this, because there were a few trees in the creek and the signs of being the house being built. So she thought, well, maybe I can take this after all. But it was such a hardship for coming to this strange land and completely different than her childhood or how she had been raised, and three children that she didn't know very well. And but she was a hearty soul and very fine stepmother and a rancher's wife and so forth. So anyway, they established the ranch and lived their entire lives here. All those people who came and settled the West, I really admire them because they had so many hardships. They were tough people. One year, in the San Luis Valley, which is Alamosa, area, a different part of the state, kind of severe area, but he went in as a partner and bought, I think it was 1,000 head of sheep, ewes, they were going to have calves in the spring, but they had a terrible winter. I think it was 1913, and blizzard conditions, and all the feed was covered up, or any grass, winter, it was just terrible, and they couldn't really find any feed for him. But anyway, they lost a lot of them, and just he lost a lot of money on that. But he wanted to try sheep raising, you know, ranching. But and I think a lot of people, Charlie, you don't want to do that. You know, you don't know anything about it. You're going to an area which is very susceptible to severe winters. And he just wanted to find out, you know, try it, and it didn't work. But he always said, well, I learned something. I'm not going to go in the sheep business. But he was a real pioneer thinker, trying all sorts of new things. He probably was one, the first car in the county. And of course, then he wanted steam heat in the house, which it was not a good idea here, but he had the radiators and the big boiler and furnace. And they had a little basement under part of the house. And about two or three winters after they moved in, it was probably that same winter, the sheep loss, but it was just so cold and day after day. And anyway, the boiler, I guess it froze up, and all the radiators froze up and leaked. They had one radiators in every room, you know, with the piped water into those. So it all froze up and just a heck of a mess. And it took months, I guess, to clean it up. And so he said, okay, we're going to rip them out. And he went to Denver and bought a little potbelly stoves for every room. And which was a good idea, actually, you know, go back to the original idea. because they had some wood on the creek from cottonwoods, and you could buy coal. And so then that worked fine. But he wanted to try those steam heater radiators. He'd seen them in hotels or something, was impressed. But they were not for here. So he always was trying something different. And it was funny, he just had a curiosity. Later, he and a veterinarian from Texas, they formed the O.M. Franklin Serum Company, vaccines and pharmaceuticals for cattle. So he set up a sales office in Chihuahua, Mexico, as well as Cuba, but he knew that there was a need for that there because so many cattle numbers, and they didn't have anything. And of course, then there was livestock diseases. There was no way to treat them. So they established, he and this Dr. Franklin, and they named it O.M. Franklin Serum Company after this vet who discovered a vaccine. And then they would test the cattle. Here, this was kind of the experiment station. They'd try all the different vaccines and here at the ranch. Charlie was very colorful and spirited, and knew everybody. He knew people all over because of his travels in the livestock industry, in politics, and then he was well. Then he started the bank in Kit Carson, and so many people, even to this day, family members, they'll say, you know, they'd go in for a loan, and Charlie said, "Oh, I don't know if you've got enough collateral." And then he'd think about, oh yeah, I'm willing. He would always be willing to make a loan, and they give him credit to helping so many people around to get started or to buy a little farm or ranch. And so he was very community minded. I mean, he's well loved by everybody.
If you got the money, I've got the time, we'll go home.
She loved to raise chickens, and they always had milk cows and a chore boy that would milk the cows and take care of the chickens. But she really was proud of those, and she wanted to be sure they had enough feed. She'd walk down there. They had a chicken house down near the barn, and she would check up on the chickens every day and gather the eggs. And said oftentimes, when she's gathering the eggs, she'd grab up a snake where they laid their eggs. She'd just toss it out and go on, gather more eggs. And so she really kept track of those eggs. And on Saturdays, a train would come in Kit Carson, and people would take their cream in to be sold, and it would be shipped to Denver, and they would make butter and for use in the city, I guess, the cream and milk. And then you'd take your eggs there too. And she was so proud. She wanted to be sure she got plenty of eggs to sell. So she kind of rationed them to the cowboys because she wanted to sell them instead of using the kitchen. And they'd kid her all the time, "Mary, when are you going to loosen up those eggs? We need more eggs and cream." She didn't ever drive, but she'd have a cowboy take her to town in the wagon. And then when they got cars, I guess in the 20s or something, but she still didn't drive. But anyway, she continued doing that for years, going to town on Saturday with her eggs and cream. So she just kind of wanted that money, and they always called it her egg money. They never knew what she did with it. But anyway, she was a character, and just really very good to children. And of course, his two sisters, Pauline and Georgia, thought Mary really spoiled Don. He was this little boy, you know, and they thought he was her favorite, whether he was or not. But she really looked out for Don. And Charlie, he became involved, of course, that serum company. He traveled around to check all the business on that, how it was doing in different offices all over. And then he became involved with the legislature. He was a state senator. And then he would go to Washington on behalf of the ranchers and farmers to set up a farm credit system where they could get loans and so forth. He was instrumental in doing that. So because of those things, he traveled quite a bit. But Mary, when he was gone, she could carry on pretty well in the cowboys, you know, and he'd kind of tell them, and she'd tell them what to do sometimes if they needed to be straightened out. She'd, you know, Charlie said to do this, and they didn't like a woman telling them what to do, but she was very good at it. And she'd hear a homesteader maybe have to leave because they couldn't make it with a small amount of land, and she would buy one of those farms, maybe 160 acres, when she heard. And I guess maybe that's what she did with her egg and cream money, that she saved it and would buy a little piece of land every now and then. And so she had several farms in her possession, and she loved to keep track of those. My grandfather, he believed very much in education, although he only had, a sixth grade education or something. So my dad went to Kansas State University. Charlie had a lot of friends in the cattle industry who were connected. That Dr. Franklin, who discovered the vaccine, had graduated from K-State. And then Don, he wasn't the perfect student. My grandfather, he thought he was having so much fun. And I think one semester he said he was going to have him work at the St. Louis stockyards. And instead of going to school, because he said, you're not taking advantage of it, you're wasting money, you're not making good grades. And my dad thought, well, I'm doing as best as I can. But anyway, he had him quit and go work, and that was East St. Louis. I guess at that time was really tough at stockyard areas, and just really a challenge to live there or work there. And the stockyards, it was tough work, sorting cattle and feeding them and hauling manure. And you know, he worked harder than he ever had here on the ranch, as far as that goes. But Charlie knew the owner of the stockyards, and he said, you know, I want you to really give him a education and working for somebody else. So he worked there for several years, and then he came back to the ranch, and Charlie really put him to work here and kind of in charge of a lot of the cattle and so forth. It was a good thing he had that experience, I think, at the stockyards, because he learned a lot. That was the same way my husband, Raj. He believed that the boys should work with somebody else first, maybe come back to the ranch, but they should work for another boss to appreciate their dad and the family. So that was kind of the philosophy of the family.
When you see my baby walking down the street, boy, she's mine, all mine. When you see that gal that's got the rest all beat, she's mine.
My mother, Blanche Brown is her maiden name, arrived in Kit Carson on a very hot afternoon in August to begin her teaching career here in Kit Carson. And there are, I think, three or four other young teachers coming at the same time. And so at least they had each other kind of encourage each other. But when they arrived in Kit Carson, it was just such a bleak picture. Everything was gray and no trees or flowers or anything. And they were shown the kind of boarding house where they would be staying, and it was kind of ramshackle, gray boarded house. It's still standing in Kit Carson, believe it or not, but it's been added onto and rebuilt. That's where they started as state boarders at this place, which was about two blocks from the school. They thought, well, they'd give it a day or two, or maybe a week when school started the next week. And then they might just return home to a nicer area. As they settled in, and they liked the school, they liked the students, and then they met these bachelors, including my dad. There were probably five or six young ranch guys that knew these teachers were coming and were very anxious to meet them, in which they did. And my mother started dating another fellow, but by Christmas she was dating my dad. And they just had so much fun. She just this group, they did a lot of things. You'd think in a small town there's not much going on, but there were dances and card parties and community dinners and so forth. They just kept busy. So then they were married the next Christmas in Fort Collins at her parents. But when she arrived, she said, "I would never have believed that I would spend the rest of my life in this town or this area, because it was just so foreign to her." But she loved it, and she wouldn't have left for anything. She just really liked the area and the people, and just completely happy as could be.
Mine, all mine. Her lips are smiling for me all the time, and rain or shine.
I was born September 3rd, 1933, in Fort Collins, Colorado. In those days, there wasn't a doctor living here. There was not a hospital in Kit Carson. And mother had been raised in Fort Collins, which then was a town of probably 8,000 approximately, but anyway, had good doctors and a hospital. And so she had decided, and my dad also concluded, that she should go up to Fort Collins to have me with the old family doctor. And she went up, I think, about 2 weeks before I was born and stayed up there. And about two weeks afterwards, she stayed before coming back here. The only thing about my childhood, I always was very envious. All my friends had all these cousins. And I wasn't lonely, because my parents, if they took a little trip, they always included one of my friends or something. So I always had company, which was really nice. I always had a good time doing that. But I just thought it would be wonderful to have two or three sisters. You know, I would just, and it would have been, but that wasn't meant to be. Pauline and Georgia, the two aunts, they didn't have any children. One was divorced, and one, they just didn't have any children. So I had, on both sides, there was no chance for cousins. That's one thing I missed, but I tell myself I made it up with my children and their cousins. I have very good, fond memories of my grandfather. He always had a dog with him. In later years, his name was Snappy, and he rode with him on the back of the saddle, or all the dogs he had. He'd take them with him, and they loved it. They'd just jump on the back of the saddle and hang on and ride around. And then my grandfather, he would take me. I would ride with him on my horse. But one day, we were out down here by the windmill. This dog, it was one that didn't usually go with us. He was kind of a mongrel. But he came barking down there and running, and anyway, it spooked my horse, and he bucked me off. Well, I wasn't ready. I mean, I didn't expect it. And Charlie wouldn't have gotten bucked off, or my dad or anything, but I was just sitting there. And my granddad, oh, he was so upset. I mean, he's so worried. And that dog, he said, "Get out of here. Don't come back." And I said, "No, it was not his fault." And but he was really upset with that dog. And it didn't hurt that much. I recovered very quickly. But he liked to have a dog. I would go with him quite a bit. And he was a crazy driver, because he learned to drive so late in life. You know, he was just a horseback person or a wagon. I would go riding. We didn't have pickups, but he would want to take this, I think it was an old Ford or something, and it made so much racket, and he would just let the clutch so out so fast, you know, just jerked every time, jerk, jerk, jerk. We'd go longing. And I think my parents didn't really want me to ride with him, because he was a dangerous rider. He would run into things. And this tree over here that Toby Mamie had made into the cowboy carved, it was there for years, alive. And they said he ran into that more times. He would back in it, or he just didn't understand driving. He was just oblivious to learning to drive, but he insisted driving. could get around and look at the cattle when he didn't want to ride. And one time going to town, Pauline was with him. And she said he was just going not that fast, probably, but for then, because there's not any road or anything, it was just kind of a trail. And he was, Pauline said he was probably going 40, and he was talking and throwing his hands and looking at cattle. And she said she just knew they were going to have a wreck. Well, they did. They ran into something along that little path. Maybe it was the windmill or something. And he said, well, golly, I just didn't see that. She had seen it for a couple miles, you know, and worrying about it. But he just was a character. And ruined more cars, you know, wrecked them, and he'd go out and buy another one and wreck it, and oh. But everyone thought he would die in a car accident, but he didn't. So anyway, it was, but Mary, like I say, she didn't ever drive. I think she was scared to drive after riding with him. She didn't want any part of driving. But then she, later, she bought a car. And she'd have me, I was in high school and I had a driver's license, and she'd have me drive her to church every Sunday. Or sometimes she'd have me take her little distances for a meeting or something, you know, I'd drive her around. And that car was really, it was an old Buick, and she kept it. She was always wanting to have the oil changed and have it washed. She really cared a lot about it, but... after she died, of course, we kept it around for quite a while because it was a good car, but we finally got rid of it. But no, they always were funny characters, and Charlie was just probably impulsive would be one word for him, because he would try everything, and whether he knew how to do it or not. And I was very close to my father, and of course, I was his son, I guess. You know, he didn't have one. So he would explain everything to me pretty young, I think. I started going with him in the pickup and riding with him, and just whatever was going on the ranch, I just took part in it. And Mother didn't have a chance teaching me anything about domestic things or the household, because I was always out with him. But Mother was just a wonderful, loving, kind person, and I nurtured me so well, I think. I'm really grateful for her. She was just so consistent and steady, always there, and always home after school. Wonderful cook, and being a home ec teacher, of course, she was a good cook, and then she was a wonderful seamstress, too. She made up clothes for me and herself, and she was very clever, very artistic. I liked to be outdoors on the ranch, and I had no interest in being in the house ever until after I was married, I had to be. And I like to cook now, but I had no interest in sewing or anything like that. Charlie died in 44, he was 73. So he was logical, Don to step in the ranch, and he stepped in as the president of the Franklin Serum Company, and he was appointed to fill my grandfather's seat in the state senate also, and then he went on to run a couple terms too on his own, but so he followed his very closely in Charlie's footsteps, and this Cattlemen's national president and so forth. But he was very capable, my dad too. I mean, he really grasped things very well. And of course, he'd been around Charlie so much, he'd learned so much from him. So they had similar business interests or periods in their life that kind of followed suit. World War II, up until that time, we always had probably at least eight cowboys, and they lived over here in this bunkhouse. The cook was in the main house, and she cooked all their meals. And then World War II, that took some of those cowboys, they had to be drafted. And so we were down, I think, only two during the war. And then about that time began marketing pickups, that you could get pickups to go around and check everything. And that was a big change from aside from riding horseback everywhere. It made it easier, and you had to have fewer hands. You know, you could have two versus eight or ten to do the same job. Maybe you had two, and then probably two after that for quite a while. Singing this cattle call. Well, it was busier, and it had more businesses now. It had two nice little grocery stores, about three restaurants, about six service stations, whereas now there's one, and there's one grocery store, one restaurant. Well, there's part of it, another restaurant, but it's not open very much. And then there was a complete hardware store. It's closed. And there was a little Hazel's Toggery that for work shirts or gloves or something, you know, the basics for men's work clothes sold there. And the bank, of course, it's still there. There was a bar that's no longer there. There's a liquor store now. And when I was in school, there were probably 180 K through 12. And now I think it's 110 about. And there was a drugstore with a counter, a soda fountain. So we often went down to there after school to get a Cherry Coke, or I remember what it was called, a Jersey. It was two scoops of ice cream in a little Coke glass, Coca-Cola. I remember that, seeing that Coca-Cola. And then chocolate sauce and malt. They just sprinkled the malt over the chocolate. And that was very popular with everyone. There were probably three or four girls in ag school at that point. And then I was on the judging team, and I was the only girl in the judging team for a couple of years. And I loved that. We went to Chicago and Fort Worth and San Francisco for contests. And that was really one of the most beneficial things I did. I mean, as far as to apply to the ranching business, we judged sheep, horses, dairy, hogs, and beef cattle. Well, I was tried out. My mother had been, so I followed. Well, then Jody, she also was. And I think we all really loved that. I mean, we made so many friends there, and it was very important. But I was really busy and involved a lot with, well, rodeo club, livestock club. I was an officer of those. Well, that summer I came back here, and then I had two very good Tri-Delt friends. Well, the one girl, she had a job teaching in Scottsdale near Phoenix. And the other girl and I, we said, well, we'll just go with you and we'll get a job down in Phoenix, because we thought that'd be fun, which it was. And I worked at the Arizona National Livestock Show. So I worked there, and then that's where I met my husband, Raj. He came there out of school. He'd gone to Bowdoin College in New England. My real good friend Jean, who had the teaching job, in fact, she had gone down in August to get started with teaching, and Jenny and I didn't go in until late September. But she found an apartment. And at the apartment, some of these the bachelors were the GE guys. In those days, now, of course, multiple lovely apartments, but then there were very few. So, I mean, it was just really difficult to find a nice apartment. But she did, and we lived there. Well, and then he was living there with these GE bachelors, others. And we'd, you know, get together at the pool, and it was a very nice bunch of people, single, some other teachers lived there. in anything. He was very athletic and instilled that in the children. I'm not a bit, I'm kind of a klutz. He was good at everything, and they all are too. So then my dad had emphysema and a bad case of it. And I, of course, being an only child, he said, we'll either have to sell the ranch unless we all were interested in coming up here and live, you know, and run it. So we took quite a long time to decide, and we decided we would like to come back and raise the family here, which we did. And Raj just loved, he fell right in, you know, he just loved it. He, all aspects of it, from digging post holes to riding to hauling water, whatever, you know, he just fit in. He was very athletic, very active person. So he liked doing something physically hard and work. And so it fit him real well, I guess, because he loved it.
I looked at it as a big adventure. And I think, you know, Mom and Dad kind of talked about it as being an adventure. When we were kids, every summer, we'd come out to Kit Carson, stay on the ranch. And it would be during the hot summer months in Phoenix. And I think my dad would take a week or two off and come and spend it with us, usually during the branding season. We would stay maybe a month. And so we were familiar with the place and we loved it. And so the move for me wasn't at all, you know, traumatic or anything. I wasn't in school, so it wasn't like I was leaving friends. And it just looked like one big adventure to me.
Scott was, let's see, we came up here, I think when he was a third grade, and Don was a second grader. And of course, Toby was just a little guy.
You know, so this is basically what I remember growing up.
I was probably five. So I started first grade in Kit Carson and then went to school here all my years through school until I graduated from high school.
Earliest memories would probably be like going out in the pickups or touring around the ranch with my dad or the ranch hands, looking at cattle or fences, windmills.
On the ranch, I loved it out here, but it was so fun to go to town. You could actually ride a bike on the streets. Here on the ranch, to ride a bike, you run into stickers and rocks and gravel. And in town, they're just other people. So when we were young, we just explore around town. And then as we got into high school and kids started having cars, one great sport was we called ditch 'em. And there'd be maybe, I'll say, six cars involved, two or three kids in each car, and it was essentially hide and seek with cars. There isn't much for a local police authority in Kit Carson, so we never had to worry about that much. But one car would be it, and the other cars would hide. And you would try to get back to base before that the it car found you. So we'd be sneaking and driving through backyards and hiding in lots, and it was a really big adventure for us. But it was fun entertainment.
You know, I remember riding at 5 years old or so, roughly, you know, on our family's gatherings and, you know, certain tasks, brandings, you know, it seems like at brandings, about as soon as I, you know, three or four or five could walk pretty well, you know, would be given little jobs.
I would say as you age, you got more responsibilities, but from a young age, a lot of it would be tagging along with Dad to go check pastures, water, maybe to feed in the winter months. For years, as kids, any chance we had, we were probably picking up. Like, anywhere you went, if you're going through a pasture, if there's wire or old post, we were picking those up. I remember spending, seems like several days just picking up bones, you know, just random from cattle that died in the past, bones. And I think Dad was a master at giving us busy work just to keep us out of trouble.
The boys, that always kid that he'd wake them up, said, okay, boys, and we're going to work on a mile of fence. And they'd say, oh, we don't want to go. And, oh, it's going to be fun. We'll have a good time. Everything, he was always that, we'll get along and we'll have a great time. It'll be fun.
My dad had a great attitude about everything was going to be fun. He's always like, do you want to go with me to check pastures? Because it's going to be fun. It was kind of convincing. And then 5 hours later, we missed lunch and, you know, you're tired and thought, Well, that, I don't know how much fun that was, but it was special. You know, you spend a lot of time with your parents, and I never expected to be paid, never expected to be, you know, never like, why do I have to do this? It was just a part of growing up. You didn't know any different, and it really was fun. You're outdoors and staying busy, and that was all good. And looking back, it's a great way to grow up.
Like the Brandings or Weanings, you always, when you go to that area, it always brings back memories of like when I was a kid, you know, who was there, the people that were helping Branding at that time. You know, through the years, a lot of people have come and gone, and, you know, family members or non-family members, and the land does tie you to the family. Ranching is a culture where, you know, you're kind of the greenhorn, you know, somebody, an outsider is a greenhorn, and, you know, I can see that it had to be tough for him to come here and, you know, try to manage. And, you know, the environment is, it grows on you, but, you know, I'm sure when he first came, you know, it was a very tough environment to get used to and get settled in. But, you know, I think at the end, he probably loved it more than, you know, I mean, I think this was his home for sure.
The National Cattlemen's Association, they give an award every year at the convention. It was in that year, it was at San Diego. He was presented with the Cattleman Businessman of the Year. And he had just learned he had cancer, lymphoma, in about 2 weeks before that convention. So, that meant so much to him. And he was so worthy because he treated ranching not only as manual labor, which he liked, to be out working, riding, and all the hard work that goes with it, hauling bales, and it's a lot of labor. But it was challenged about the business end of it. How do you make a profit? How do you know when you really should sell the cattle? What the opportunities of improving the nutrition or pregnancy rates, conception, just all these things that he loved to make a study of all those things. And so they recognized that. And that was so wonderful because it came at such a good time. We were going to church for Christmas Eve services, and he was putting up on his tie. He had put on a white shirt, and he couldn't get it buttoned. He said, "Polly, you really shrank this shirt." And I said, "No, you're just putting weight on." You know, we kind of kidding around. Well, so a couple days later, he had started swelling in his throat, you know, for the lymphoma. So he went to Shine Wells, a little hospital, and there was a doctor there who was good. He says, "I'm afraid even to say this, but you might have lymphoma." He felt everything, you know. But he said, "I think you should go either Denver or something to really get a complete testing." Well, he had a real good friend, a Bowden friend, who was a surgeon. He'd gone through Harvard Medical School, and he called him. And he said, "You should get to Mayo Clinic. Go to either Rochester or Scottsdale. Tell them what's going on, and you want a complete testing and see what's the diagnosis." So within three days, we were in Scottsdale, and he had went through all the testing, and they found out by the second day it was lymphoma, and was in and out of the hospital until November. He wanted to go to Branson, Missouri. That was another thing. He and my dad together had fell in love with a farm near Branson, Missouri. In 1962, maybe, they bought this farm, and he planned to have a planned community, marinas, golf course, and everything. And he had talked to several developers, and we were going back to visit one that had shown a real interest in it. But I didn't think he was able to because he'd had several transfusions, and his doctor was in Colorado Springs. And he just was, definitely, we have to go to Branson. And I said, "Rod, you just not wait until spring when the weather's good and reliable, and we can really enjoy it and take longer to go and be much better than now. Your health is not that good." And my mother, she and Raj were really good friends and got along so well. And she never interfered in anything. Or we all were having dinner over that up the big house, and we were leaving the next morning for Branson. And I just dreaded it, you know, because we had to take all this oxygen and all his medicine, and he was not good, you know, he was just not able. And my mother said, Raj, I never want to tell you what to do, but I don't think you and Polly should go to Branson. You just put it off. And he said, well, I'm sorry, Blanche, but I'm just going to insist that we go. I want to go. I think he was just knew, you know, that his time was up or something. And so we went, and that was that day. It's a two-day trip. We had more road construction and bad weather, and I wanted to stop in Wichita for the night. And he said, no, we got to go on, get farther down the road. So we went to Wellington, a little town about like Kit Carson. They have trains stop there that cruise and take up all the motel space. Finally, we found a motel room, but he was just exhausted. And we got, you know, everything, got him to bed and all his meds. And we watched some news, I remember. He was commenting about that. And then I woke up about 4:30, and I just knew he had died. He never called out or anything, you know, very quietly. He just died. I believe he really wanted to go and not die at home, maybe, or in our bedroom or something, you know, be away. And he wanted to get to Branson because he wanted to see that project go ahead, you know. And, of course, that didn't happen. But so I said, well, the night before, so, okay, Raj, if you really want to go, I'll take you. And he said, well, I would appreciate that so much. That means so much to me. So I felt that we should go at the, you know, the very last, I had consented, but I wasn't happy about it because I just felt he should be home near a doctor or something. But it was meant to be. I mean, I don't think he would probably live, if he'd been here, I don't think he would last for 2 or 3 days maybe. But he didn't want to go back in the hospital. That was one thing. He'd been in the hospital so much. And he said, please don't ever take me back to a hospital. I said, well, I'll try to promise that, but that's hard to promise.
Oh, can the circle be unbroken?
When Dad died, as hard as it was, she was still very strong. And I remember his funeral, a lot of people came and people traveled, and he was loved by everyone. He was a great guy. And before the funeral, she said, now there's going to be a lot of people here, and I want you, you know, you need to make it a point to go talk to everybody you see and visit with them and spend time with them. And it wasn't about us. And it wasn't about, you know, they're coming for us. It's like, you are going to be there for them. And, you know, that was just expectations, and I thought that was so admirable because it could be, you know, a lot of people would be, you know, in a hole or in a corner somewhere curled up feeling sorry for themselves. And, you know, that I don't think is even in Mom's mindset at all. You know, you'd think of others first, and she's always very appreciative of everyone. And I mean, it was a hard time, and we probably had time to prepare for it, but it's still a shock. And Dad was kind of one of those people. He was very healthy and active. And I remember thinking, you know, if cancer can get him, it can get anybody. And it's kind of a reality check because I just thought, he's going to live forever. And then when he got it, and it was a bad, aggressive cancer, it just kind of rocks your world.
You know, my mom's always been a very strong person, very believe in her faith, so I think that's kind of helped her through that time. But, you know, yeah, I mean, her strength and beliefs has always been something that has impressed me a lot because, you know, my father, it was a great loss, but I think she had the strength to carry on very as well and, you know, not panic, and you know, just make wise decisions.
She just kind of picked up and went on, and I'm sure it was hard because, you know, you're missing this essential, integral person and part of the operations. But, you know, we never really saw that. She didn't act helpless or anything. And I know it was probably a hard transition. And I think Dad knew, you know, he may not beat this, so I think he tried to prepare as much as he could, and that probably helped a lot too.
Toby was at the TC, Texas Christian Ranch Management at the time. First after college, you know, he wasn't sure, and we didn't put any pressure. We said, if you want to be a stockbroker or work in Denver business, that's just do what you want. We have no pressure to come back. And then after, when Raj was getting more seriously ill, he said, I really think I would like to come back to the ranch. And I think that relieved Raj so much.
Both my mom and dad were very good at, you know, we should, all of us siblings should try to find jobs elsewhere, or, you know, get exposed somewhere else. And it was, I think, a good time in my life to come back. So I think I was ready, and yeah, I think I appreciated it more, you know, having a little time away and be able to come back and with that fire in the belly to ranch.
I did never really feel pressured, you know, to continue the ranch, but I wanted to. I hoped it would be possible to keep in the family.
You know, it's a lot of pressure in a way. You know, I love it, but it is a lot of pressure because, you know, my grandfather and, you know, throughout the generations, my mom, dad, they've done such a great job trying to pass the ranch and the heritage and traditions down. So when I want to continue that tradition, that heritage, you know, you don't want to be the generation that messes it up for the future generations. Well, unfortunately for me, when I came back, I've kind of seen the best and the worst. The 90s, we had, you know, just above average rainfall, that some of the best years ever. And then a lot of the 2000s, we've had fires and some of the worst droughts in the history of the ranch. And that's, you know, agriculture is just so tough because you're relying on Mother Nature so much. You know, you try to do the best you can do. So many things that are out of your control that makes it tough.
Ranching people, you know, it's kind of like a brotherhood or something. They always, they could just immediately begin visiting by about the cattle or something in some common ground. I really admire my grandfather, you know, that started this, and he didn't make a big issue of it, but, you know, he'd say, well, maybe some of your grandchildren will end up here.
It's fun to see now this new, our kids' generation is now the cousins. They talk a lot, you know, they talk about the future of this place and the future of the family, and they're very engaged and interested in, they're interested in oil and gas development and property acquisitions and building cattle herds. And so you can just see, it's really fun and exciting to see this, the next generation sees that as important, and they're working together and they're curious and they want to expand and help the family legacy thrive, and they're very committed to that, I think. So it'll be fun to see as the years progress what happens with the next generation.
Work ethic, I think it's ingrained in them pretty well, the kids, and all of them, and it has been. And I, whether my grandfather set that standard, probably, but they had to. In those days it was so hard, they had to work hard. And so, I mean, it's kind of evolved. They just followed his example, I think, and it's gone through the generations. They're number one. And I'm very appreciative, and I mean, they're everything that, to me. I wouldn't be able to do anything without them. They helped me so much. And friends, I think, my friends are very special, and I maintain a connection with so many. Some people have their lives, they're so busy they don't need it, I think. But I, for my well-being, I need to be connected to family and friends and faith. The three F's, family, friends, and faith. And I value in each one very much.
She's very fun-loving and positive and easygoing. You know, she never complains. Never, ever negative. And so when she doesn't feel very good, if she says that, she probably really doesn't feel well, because she just never complains, is always pleasant. She's always had class. I've never seen her do anything that doesn't, you know, is classless or degrading or anything towards any, and she treats everyone very well. She knows people and talks and visits with people, and she still fixes meals for different people that need it or helps with funeral dinners. And, no, she's just a great example of how to live your life.
Just seeing her strength and how she always counted her blessings, you know, every day, I think she was good at that. And I think, you know, hopefully some of that's rubbed off on me to always be thankful for what you have.
There's no excuse for me not to turn out the way I did, because I had a great life, great childhood, no stress. I mean, probably the biggest stress was getting late to the school bus or getting a B on a paper, and that's nothing compared to what a lot of people went to through. So I'm very grateful for the way we grew up. You know, we traveled, we worked, we lived on a cattle ranch. That's a dream of a lot of people, and it doesn't seem very glamorous to us, but you know, what a great way to live. You know, we went horseback riding with our dad 2 or 3 times a week all summer long. Our parents went to every game we participated in. So, and in addition to that, you know, they've led by example, just their values. You know, they didn't do anything that we were embarrassed of. You know, they had good values. They were good people. They treated people right. And so you can't really put a price on that. And I still look and think, like I said, I have no excuse not to turn out to be a decent person. There's no reason not to be, because I had the best examples.
Well, I'm a Methodist, but I believe in faith that gets you a long way. And I try to impart that to them. I mean, that's played a real important part of my life. And I give it credit for so much. You know, I just depend on God so much. I mean, it probably sounds silly, but, you know, I pray for very insignificant things. But I believe that prayers are answered, and I just have that feeling that God is working and working hard to watching over us, to protect us, the family. And I know there'll be some sadness, and there is, and, you know, in the past and so forth. But I think it enables you to endure and go forth to each day is a new day. And if you flubbed up one day, that's going to be better tomorrow, that you can overcome it.
You know, the love of the land, I think all of the generations that kept it going so much has had the love of the land and the livestock. And, you know, I think you have to have that passion, you know, for what you do. And in ranching, you know, you definitely have to have a passion for the land and the livestock. And, you know, and I hope the future generations, you know, don't feel obligated to have to farm or ranch. But if they have that passion and desire, you know, I hope my generation will, you know, put them in a good spot where they continue on, you know, with that, with ranching.
I think my grandfather generally would be very pleased to see the family involved. He would probably be astounded as the modern rancher, you know, all the, like the pipelines and, well, the selling cattle would be so foreign to him on the video. But at the same time, he was such a pioneer, and he loved new things too. And my dad too. Raj, they all would be fascinated and accepted.
The red man was pressed from this part of the West. 'Tis unlikely he'll ever return to the banks of Red River, where seldom, if ever,